Welcome to the study of water resource engineering. In the last session, we have studied about the objectives of water resources, the world water resources, and we have also studied about irrigation in India and its necessity. In today's session, we will be studying about hydrology. The contents that will be covered in today's topic will be that is a brief introduction to hydrology, importance of hydrology, application of hydrology, and the most important part, that is hydrological cycle, and the last part, that will be a test of multiple choice questions. Now, what do you mean by hydrology? Why should we study hydrology? Hydrology, it is basically derived from Greek word hydro means water and logy means science. Hence, hydrology means it's a science of water. To be more specific, it is a science dealing with occurrence, circulation, distribution, and properties of the waters of the earth and earth atmosphere. So, we also define hydrology that it is nothing but the scientific study of Earth's water, especially with relation to the effects of precipitation and evaporation upon its occurrences and character of water in streams, lakes, and on or below the land surface. So this particular slide shows how water is distributed on the Earth. We already know that Earth is a blue planet due to abundant water on its surface. And also we know that about 71% of the Earth's surface is covered with water. So the oceans hold about 97% of all Earth's water, which is saline. In the image, you can see that about 97% of water is present in oceans and seas. So, only 3% of fresh water is present with low concentration of salts and glaciers. So, out of this 3%, about 2.06% of water is present in the form of ice caps and glaciers. Hence, the remaining available fresh water, that is 0.94%, it is the only water that is present which can be used by all living beings. And above all, you can see in the second circle that about 0.94% of available fresh water, 0.903% of water is present in the form of groundwater, whereas 0.009% of water is present in lakes and rivers. And water is present in other forms like soil moisture, streams, etc. So now we already know how water is distributed on the earth. Then, what is the importance of hydrology here? Hydrology, it is an extremely important field dealing with one of the most valuable resources on earth, that is water. So, all aspects of the Earth's available water is studied by the experts, that is from geologists to engineers, to obtain the information needed to manage this resource. So, it is a basic knowledge essential for the irrigation engineer. It also deals with the person who deals with the development, utilization, and management of water resources. So, an engineer can work out the best use of water supplies for irrigation and control river flooding and also soil erosion. And second most important thing is assessing the quantity of water available for irrigation and also for hydropower, industrial water supply, municipal water supply and other purposes. As we already know, climate which affects the water cycle by changing the amount of water that is available in atmosphere at any time. So it also changes the rate of evaporation, which indirectly affects water holding capacity of the atmosphere. So we civil engineers use the information observation and data collected by the hydrologist, and this knowledge is used to design, build and operate the dams and reservoirs. And next, the most important part of hydrology is study of effects on river water levels after the construction of this proposed reservoirs or any other controlling structures. So after studying the importance of hydrology, how it can be applied? That is application of hydrology. So it is basically used in the design of hydraulic structures. While designing the structures, the development activity should have no impact on existing condition, that is in case of storms, flood, etc. And in such cases, the application of hydrology plays a very important role. So next, that is estimation of water resources. Estimation of water resources, this study is essential for the success of any project. That is dams, for the construction of dams, barrages, canals, all require the study of available water resources. And this information can be obtained by studying hydrology. And coming to the third application, that is to study the process such as precipitation, runoff, evapotranspiration and their interaction. So this is where we study the historical rainfall data, land usage type and terrain of the ground to calculate runoff, discharge, flow that could result in one particular area. So next, the study of problems such as floods and droughts and strategies to combat them. This is where hydrology comes into play. Depending on the location and type of project, there will be a design standard set up by the local authorities, and this basically helps in solving these problems. And next, determination, it is also used in the determination of suitable site for hydroelectric power plants. With a thorough knowledge of hydrology, we can decide a particular location for these power plants. It is also very useful in calculation of capacity of reservoir from the previous rainfall records. By obtaining the previous rainfall data in one particular area, you can calculate the capacity of the reservoir. Now, coming to the hydrological cycle, which is the most important part of today's session. So hydrological cycle, it is nothing but the scope of hydrology, which may be defined as that portion of cycle from precipitation to evaporation or return to the water to the seas. It is nothing but understanding how water interacts with the environment, including how it moves from Earth's surface to the atmosphere and then back to the Earth. This is never-ending movement, which we call it as a hydrological cycle. So you can see from this schematic representation that water from the ocean get evaporated, where sun is the main driving force. And due to this, the evaporation of water, it can get condensed and forms the clouds. And these clouds later on results in precipitation. So the precipitation again may occur in different forms, which we will be studying later on. And this precipitation, that is some part of it falls on the ground, some part of it falls on the ocean, and whereas some part of it falls on the mountains. And through this process, it is intercepted by various means, and later on it joins to the ocean. So this is all about the hydrological cycle. So the hydrological cycle, we also call it as a water cycle. It is the continuous movement of water between the earth and the atmosphere. Water reaches land as precipitation in the form of rain and snow. Then the water evaporates, condenses to form clouds, and then it falls on the earth again as precipitation, thus continuing the cycle. So of many processes involved, the most important are evaporation, transpiration, condensation, precipitation, and runoff, which we'll be studying later on in this session. So this is a pictorial representation of hydrological cycle, which we also known as water cycle. So water here, it takes on various forms in the environment due to change in temperature and other influences. You can see from the figure that water, which is represented in the blue rays, that is, it gets evaporated due to change in temperature, where sun is the main driving force, and then water from the surface of ocean get warmed up, which gets heated up by the sun, evaporates as water vapor. You can see the arrow mark in the figure. And as this moist air rises high into the atmosphere, it cools. It cools and condenses to form the clouds. And this moisture in the clouds then returns to the earth's surface as precipitation. So once it reaches the ground, the water is absorbed and it becomes the groundwater. So you can see here, the water which results in precipitation, it may be in different forms. When it falls on the land or ground, it is absorbed and it becomes groundwater. This groundwater is, all the groundwater is not absorbed. It will not return to rivers, streams, and finally to the oceans. Some part of the groundwater will infiltrate into the soil at a greater depth, which will later on emerge into springs and aquifers, whereas some part of the water will fall on the vegetation matter, and some of the water that is present in the soil will get evaporated by the utilization of this water from the plants through transpiration, and it is returned into the atmosphere. So, and later on, the excess water after filling up of all these lakes, rivers, and land, it moves towards the oceans. So the excess water, we call it as a runoff. So from this, you can see that how the cycle repeats itself as the surface of bodies of water, and once again it gets evaporated. So moisture that is captured by plants can also return to the atmosphere, that we call it as a transpiration. We can see from this figure where water from the vegetation matter will get evaporated, that we, what we call it as a transpiration process. So this is all about the hydrological cycle, how the cycle continues and how the water is maintained in the atmosphere. So we have already studied about the hydrological cycle, and there we have come through different terminologies, that was precipitation, evaporation, transpiration, condensation, which are the main component parts of hydrological cycle. So now we'll be studying what are these component parts of hydrological cycle. So first, we have already seen that when water gets evaporated, it again results, returns to the atmosphere in the form of precipitation. So precipitation, it may be in any form, that is rain, snow, sleet, or drizzle. So commonly we know that precipitation is a rain. So what is this rain? How do you classify between rain, snow, sleet, and drizzle? So generally, rain, it is the main form of precipitation in India, and we call it as a rain when the size of the drop is larger than 0.5 mm. Then we call it as a rainfall. So next, evaporation. Evaporation of water takes place from three sources. That is surface sources like rivers, lakes, oceans, and also from the surface of soil, and third being that is plants through transpiration. So by this process, water is converted into vapor. So Now coming to condensation. So condensation, it is nothing but it is a process by which vapor is converted into solid form, that is clouds, formation of clouds. So it is nothing but a physical state of matter from gas phase to liquid phase. It is the conversion of water from gaseous phase to liquid phase. And next, we have seen that is interception. When precipitation occurs, it is intercepted by vegetation. As I've already said, precipitation does not directly fall on the ground. It is intercepted by various means. So one such means is vegetation. So this part generally do not contribute to the surface water. Precipitation that does not reach the soil, but it is intercepted by leaves, plants, etc. So this water will never contribute directly to the surface water. And next, coming to infiltration, after water reaches the ground, it infiltrates into the ground. That is nothing but process of water entry into the soil through the earth surface. What we call it as infiltration. Water entering into the soil, we call it as infiltration. And next, most important component is depression storage. Depression storage is nothing but some part of the water is stored in depression areas that are present on the ground. That is water that is retained in ditches, ponds, wetlands, from which it evaporates or flows towards the stream or channel. What we call it as depression. And next, coming to runoff. Runoff is nothing but the remaining water which flows on ground or surface and joins channel is called surface runoff, or we can also call it as a runoff. The remaining water which flows on ground surface and joins channel is called runoff. It is that part of precipitation that it make its way towards river or ocean as surface flow. So the excess water or the excess water which results in rainfall after filling all the nearby rivers, streams, etc. will flow towards the ocean. So next, coming to groundwater flow, we also call it as an interflow. The water which is infiltrated into the ground joins the stream, which later on emerges on the later stage, it is called as an interflow. And the precipitation that falls onto the land infiltrates into the ground to become groundwater. It is this water that is formed underground in cracks and spaces in soil, sand and rocks. So in today's topic, we have discussed that is about the definition of hydrology, that is how water is distributed in the earth atmosphere and also the distribution of water on this earth surface. And also we have seen the hydrological cycle, that is how water is balanced in the atmosphere, how the cycle continues. And also the different components of hydrological cycle, that is evaporation, transpiration, what do you mean by rain, condensation, etc. And from this we come to the end of this hydrological cycle. And next we shall have a small test that will be of multiple choice questions. So this is the first question, that where does the energy to drive the hydrologic cycle come from? The driving energy for the hydrological cycle, driving source of energy for the hydrological cycle. And the choices are Earth's interior, the sun, plate tectonics, or photosynthesis. So we have already seen in the image that sun is the main driving force, and hence the answer is B, that is sun. Now coming to second question, what percentage of the earth's water is salt water? So we have already seen that how water is distributed on the earth, and the choices given here are that is 76%, 52%, 10%, 97%, and the answer is D, that is 97%. So coming to third question, most of the earth's water is in this form. Which form? Most of the earth's water is present in rivers, salt water, ice, fresh water. The answer is B, that is salt water. Next, clouds form through this process. Clouds are generally formed by which process? The choices here are that is infiltration, evaporation, transpiration, condensation. So the answer is D, that is condensation. When the water from the ocean gets heated up from the sun, they evaporates, they condenses, and then form the clouds. Coming to the last question, that is transpiration. Water turning directly from ice to water vapor, soil infiltration, or evaporation from the leaves of trees, or runoff from steep hills. So what do you mean by transpiration? Transpiration is nothing but it is the evaporation from the leaves of tree, that is C. So with this, we come to the end of this today's session. So thank you.